I am Vivian Kamsimi. Tonight on The Checkpoint, we are discussing politics and justice. And two politicians, opposition politicians today, returned to Parliament after serving a 1.5-year jail term and were recently given bail. Now, Honorable Mohamed Segirinya and Honorable Alan Sewanyana were in Parliament today, and we don't have a story of the sins that happened there on their appearance. And just before I introduce our guests, let's see what happened there.
The two lawmakers, Segirinya and Sewanyana, walked into Parliament while limping at around 1:30 p.m. in the company of their political assistants. They knelt down on the stairs of Parliament to signify victory after a long walk to temporary freedom. They were ushered in by fellow legislators, who led the two to the Deputy Speaker of Parliament, Thomas Tayewa's chambers, who welcomed them back to the August House before proceeding to the plenary. While starting off today's sitting, the Deputy Speaker of Parliament made official welcome remarks for the legislators, expressing sympathy for what happened to them.
We are excited to be welcoming back our two colleagues, the Honorable Aaron Sewanyana and the Honorable Segirinya Mohamed. We are always happy.
Later, the duo addressed the press and expressed more appreciation to Ugandans who relentlessly demanded their release from prison.
We are received by the Speaker of Parliament today, who is in chair. We talked about so many issues, and we have agreed with him that we make our statements as an explanation to the nation about our health, about our well-being, and about how we are going to serve our people and even thank the whole nation. We shall do that officially tomorrow. By the leave of the speaker.
God is good. Finally, I'm back. See, time now to represent my people of Kawempe North constituency. It has been 2 years ever since I was incarcerated in Komikado at Chigo Prison. We suffered a lot, but because of Ugandan's prayers, because of the effort by Parliament, our party headquarters, the Futu soldiers, and Ugandans at large, we are back finally.
Segirinya explained that today was his first time to sit in the official chambers of Parliament, saying he was arrested before he could get a feeling of the floor of the House or making his maiden speech.
Yeah, today I've entered the chambers for the first time, and I was guided by the Honorable Sewanyana. Even I didn't know where to sit. It was Honorable and Sewanyana who told me that now you have to sit this side, because I was going to sit in the side of those ministers, but Honorable Sewanyana guided me and directed me where to sit.
They have vowed to pick from where they stopped, as far as representation of their constituencies is concerned. They also pledged to revive programs that they started for their constituencies as they embark on returning to normal service.
We have lost so much. Our projects have collapsed. But we know that with God, everything is possible, and he will give us more energy to do them again.
The two have been scheduled on tomorrow's order paper to make personal statements regarding their ordeal. Report compiled by Fred Kajubi for the News at Parliament.
Now, the circumstances surrounding the arrest, the detention, the entire jail term of these two MPs raised a number of questions regarding the balance of administration of justice and politics. And today we look into the relationship between those two and how can the justice system be independent of partisan politics. My guests tonight are senior advocates Edgar Tabaro and political analyst Joseph Ochieno. Welcome, gentlemen.
It's good to be here.
It's good to have you, gentlemen.
Thank you. It's.
I'm looking forward to an interesting conversation
always,
here.
It's such an honor to appear here with Mr. Ochieno. I have great admiration for Mr. Ochieno. I wouldn't like to call him my personal friend because he's much older than me. We are not peers. But he's a person I've looked up to over the years. From the time he was very closely associated with the late Dr. Bote. And I've made it open. It's no secret that I have admiration for Dr. Bote's policies.
Great to hear.
But as a leader, that's another different matter altogether. But for his policies, I have a great admiration for Dr. Bote's policies. And some of us are what we are, largely because of the policies and the institutions he put in place.
It's great to hear that. Very interesting. Mm. I'm looking forward to a very interesting conversation this evening. I think a deep understanding of what justice and politics are doing to this country and how they are playing together to see some of the things we are seeing. Now, Joseph, I will go straight to you. The Honorable Segirinya and Sewanyana walked to Parliament today, humble men. In fact, Honorable Sewanyana was limping. You saw when they got to the stairs at Parliament, they were kneeling to pray. It took about 2 minutes to do that. And in Parliament, there were photographs that came in earlier when they were both seated together. And they were downcast. You could see that they were downcast. What does this to a politician?
You know, first of all, I must thank you for this program. But I must acknowledge Edgar's generous and always generous compliments to myself that I take not really lightly at all, and to the person whom I regard as my revered hero, Dr. Bote. But I think he actually makes a very important point that, notwithstanding some of his own views about, in this case, Dr. Bote, I just go straight into it, he emphasizes policies. Once in a while, he's very generous to the man. But I want to give a slight context, if you'd like me to use that. Edgar comes from a very political family, a very intellectual family, and a very legalistic family. And Edgar, if you allow me, and I'm sure you don't mind, Edgar's dad is a senior citizen of this country who, as early as the 1979, Liberation War, were amongst the Ugandans who had taken considered opinion about a post-Idi Amin Uganda, and they had their own views. So I think he was possibly one of those who were slightly much more reluctant to come into UPC, but very nationalist, you see. And so the constituent was the form called UNLF, anti-dictatorship. So if you're an objective Ugandan, you must give credit to alternative views. So some of those actually found Edgar's opinions, views and opinions. But then Edgar then emphasizes the questions of policies. Notwithstanding anything that you can talk about the pre-NRM Uganda, except for Idi Amin, even for the interim legislative assembly in which Edgar's dad and others would have been, and Mr. Museveni would have been very active people, I don't know a National Assembly that would be as possibly discomforting and discouraging under the circumstances of two new emergent legislators, one of whom is coming in for the first time under the circumstance. And you see that which you saw on the screen today. And so perhaps that tells us that we need to do serious soul searching in this country, and that notwithstanding all our political differences and political opinions, what is actually happening in our country as part of the judicial system and judicial processes, part of what is happening in the legislature, what is happening across the political processes, I mean, political parties and organizations. We need to do a lot of work. And these two guys and the manner in which they came in, and you're right, I think Edgar and I and were having a chat about this before coming on air, and I think maybe you overheard part of it, the fact that actually these guys did not come with the big wave of their supporters as they did. So it was possibly a very low-key affair, and you would wonder, why should it be low-key at this time when it would be possibly much more celebrative? Was it part of a deal? Was it the case that their arrival back has now raised more questions than answers? Has the political party and that they represent, did they not consider the fact that actually this would be a triumphant return?
A triumphant return
what
to
exactly
parliament.
To parliament? What exactly is it? And to me, that makes me feel rather saddened. Hence, the response to you using Edgar's own very kind introduction. In other words, I'm saying that this country has had difficult past, but some rather very decent pasts, for which we should deserve better today, particularly if an older person like me, wishing Edgar and yourselves much better, and my children, younger children, grandchildren, even better, and indeed all of us are here, parents, we should be using this as we analyze, as we contextualize, very objectively, I hope, recognizing that whatever we do today, we are doing it not for God and my country only, but those of us in Mwiri would say we trying to do so, building also for the future. Building off of the future.
I'm having a very interesting show. I have a Murian and Ngonian, so you can imagine.
It's like a better school than his.
Next topic.
I expected that. You did hint about negotiations, but just before we get there, Councillor Edgar, looking at the judicial process, let's look at this judicial process that led to their release. Let's say from the time of their arrest to detention, then we had that time where they were given bail and then rearrested. And then now, after some time, we see them coming out on bail. Now we can see them getting to parliament. What is this judicial process that has taken its course to deliver them to parliament?
There's what they call the justice, law and order sector. It has many ambits to it. There is the judiciary, the institution before whom accused persons are arraigned. There's the investigative ambit of the justice, law and order sector, and that involves the Criminal Investigation Department and its affiliates, Criminal Investigation, Crime Intelligence. Then you have the Prosecutorial Department, which is the Directorate of Public Prosecutions. They have very different dynamics to it. When a crime is committed, it is the responsibility of the Criminal Investigation and Crime Intelligence Directorate to investigate. And they have apparatus that they assemble. Then upon assemblage of the evidence, it's taken to the Prosecutorial Department, which is the Directorate of Public Prosecutions. And upon the evidence that they've come, that has come to the attention, they make a decision whether to prosecute the person or not. Now, in this case, I don't want to go into the evidential.
Yes, because the matter is even before court
and we are precluded Some of you in your position, you can maybe go into that, but I'm an officer of court. I'm an advocate of the High Court of Uganda.
Which has 23 years
experience. I taught constitutional law, constitutional law administrative processes at university. So as such, I'm deeply alive to the rule on sub judice.
Yes.
There's always been that question, a jurisprudential question, and there are instances where the sub judice rule can be done away with. I don't want to go into that arena for reasons that this is a matter that is emotive in some some sections of this society.
Certainly, yes.
Especially the political elite. But I'd like to state my personal positions.
Yes.
One, when a court has granted bail and the state rearrests the person, that does not augur well for the rule of law and respect of sanctity of the courts. This is irrespective of our political lenses.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This is irrespective of our political lenses. Court decisions must be respected.
Yes.
Whichever person, whichever institution disagrees with the court decision, they must do so, one, with respect to the institution of mm-hmm. court. Mm-hmm. Two, there are remedies to correct what you think is a wrong.
Mm.
There's review, there's revision. In the case of bail, there's no opportunity for appeal, but there's opportunity for review. Either the evidence that was presented at the time, or there's newer emerging evidence. Either the persons, for instance, if you release person on bail, and maybe they give statements outside court that bring the institution of the judiciary into disrepute. That can be one avenue, say that they respect court and they're likely to be a flight risk, or no, they're not likely to be court orders. Now, but the bottom line is where bail has been given, we should all respect it. Two, what are the circumstances? What has changed so much that at the time they were granted bail the first time and rearrested, and this time that they have given bail once again, what are the circumstances that have changed so much that they should permit bail? Because on this occasion, the DPP filed a certificate of no objection. In other words, they had no objection to the bail. And, well, I'll put it very bluntly, there were negotiations.
Are you sure?
There were negotiations over
sure?
the release. They were led by DP President Norbert Mao, the Honorable Minister of Justice and Constitutional Affairs. And, you know, many things the world over, or many events the world over, turn on information that is not available to the public. Now, there were killings, targeted killings in massacre. The killings were politically motivated. The evidence that is available is that the killings were carried out or orchestrated by a political elite in Uganda. Now, as to whether or not it was Honorable Sewanyana and Honorable Mr. Updates, the Segrinya as he calls himself, that is another matter altogether, and it's not for me to determine. But there were killings, they were politically motivated, and they were orchestrated by part of the political elite in Uganda to cause dissatisfaction towards the sitting government. They had sponsors within the region. That is a fact. So, the question you were asking, if I refresh my mind.
Yes, I was asking you about the judicial process that led to their release, but then you went on and
I went ahead of you.
Yes, yes. We were going into the accusations and counter accusations of negotiations that could have taken
the negotiations place. Did happen. They were between President Museveni and their families, and the word is that President Museveni was tired of making inverted commas political deals with politicians, because they reneged on them,
and they go and rubber rose. Getting very involved in rubber rosing. So
very
the,
interesting revelation.
So he, yeah, he did it with the families. And between the families, you've had, since the politicians were released, the families of these two politicians, their tone and tune has been markedly different from the kind of mental gymnastics and the theatrics we have seen on television.
Plus also what we saw, the Honorable Segirinya and the Honorable Sewanyana's energies and being vocal critics.
Theatrics, gallery, playing to the gallery.
These issues that got them arrested. But let me take a short break. We are going to be right back. Very interesting revelations going on in this studio. We will be right back.